name is Robert Durso, and I'm a senior faculty member and senior director of the Galensky Institute. Today, I'm going to give a lecture on teaching the single and double rotation effectively. The first thing that I'd like to say is that rotation is one component of an overall technique. This component combines with many other components to produce speed, ease, and control at the keyboard. I hope that this lecture will provide certain suggestions and guidelines for problems that come up while teaching the rotation. The first thing we would like to discuss here is alignment. Alignment comes first before motion is possible. When we line ourselves up at the instrument, we are doing that for the purpose of the finger, hand, and arm to be at the best mechanical advantage to the instrument. The purpose for the finger, hand, and arm to be aligned is so that it can drop freely into the instrument. Let us briefly discuss the sitting height and distance from the keyboard as it is described in great detail on the first video in the Taubman tapes. The sitting height puts the playing mechanism, the finger, the hand, and the arm, in the best mechanical advantage for playing the instrument. The proper place for the alignment to be is that the forearm should be level or slightly above the surface of the white keys. A very helpful way to guide someone to this is to extend a piece of paper or a book from the white keys. Just check if they're in a general place that's correct. The proper distance from the keyboard allows for total comfort. It is not good to be too close because a situation of crowding would result. Here, I am not free to maneuver the different registers of the instrument, particularly in front of the body. If I go too far back, I would be reaching for the instrument. In this position, it's not possible for the finger, hand, and arm to drop freely into the keyboard. Let's now discuss the system of fulcrums that connect limbs to each other. First, the finger, hand, and arm and the upper arm is connected to the torso at the shoulder. It is important for the shoulder not to be too high and not to be collapsed down. It is basically in a neutral position. Following down, we go to the elbow. The elbow is where the finger, hand, and arm connect to the upper arm. The elbow should be in a position where lifting and dropping the finger, hand, and arm is done with ease. If the elbow is too far out, the finger, hand, and arm will not go up and down freely. If the elbow is too collapsed in, the same situation will result. A neutral position allowing for the finger, hand, and arm to go up and down is crucial to the success of the playing. Following down to the wrist is the fulcrum from which the hand moves. It's important to realize that the wrist can neither be too high nor too low. Either situation will prevent the finger, hand, and arm being unified. Following down, we have the main knuckle joint. This is an important joint because it is where the fingers move from. The fingers move up and down in one piece from the main knuckle. In the natural hand position, you will see there are middle knuckles to the fingers. Those middle knuckles should be preserved in the playing. They should neither be straightened out nor curled. The last joint here is important not to collapse in nor to curl. So we have basically the natural position here. Once you attain the alignment for playing, the next step is to play one key at a time. The finger, hand, and arm go up and down together and descend into the key. There are several things to master here. It's important that when you're on the bottom of the key, You're not gripping the fingers to stay there. You're neither letting go of the bottom and hovering the weight up. So we call this easy solid, or being on the bottom of the key effortlessly. At this point, I'd like to clarify the rotational movement. In showing a student the rotational movement, it's very helpful to locate the arm in front of the body, like this. I would turn the palm towards the body and towards the floor. That will produce a rotational movement. Remember that the finger, hand, and arm must all move together. Towards the body, towards the floor. It's very much like turning a tennis racket. The head of the tennis racket stays in alignment. Don't always start with a large motion, especially if the student is injured. The issue here is feeling connected, finger, hand, and arm, and free to the elbow. This can be achieved with a small motion. The preparatory motion refers to the motion that begins a passage and also to the first part of a motion in the double rotation. A single rotation functions to accommodate changes of direction, such as a trill. This is a movement from left to right and right to left. The double rotation consists of two motions, the first being a preparatory motion followed by a playing swing. I like to show the rotation starting in the descending direction. I like to start with four fingers and avoid using the thumb. The reason for avoiding the use of the thumb is because we would need the in and out motions in order to play the thumb. It is much simpler to deal with just the rotation. I like to play straight down and show the rotation over a distance, say to the second finger. Sometimes it's easier for the student to understand rotation over a distance than it is to understand rotation to the very next note.